Rambling Rose was written in 1972, and it was optioned immediately by Edgar Sherrick, who was a producer who, curiously enough, and certainly a tip of the hat to him, had a vision that this could be a movie. He hired Calder to write a screenplay immediately, and that was finished in 73. They tried to get the film made many, many times, and many directors were involved. I know that one of the early incarnations of the film had Walter Matthau as Daddy, Lily Tomlin as Mother, and Goldie Hawn as Rose. And that would have been a very different movie than we made. I think that the thing that scared people in Rambling Rose in the past was the misunderstanding or not understanding of what the intention was with the sexuality in the picture. The scene between Buddy and Rose really frightened people, because when you read it on the page, your imagination can run rampant, and people could only see the vivid things that they thought were going on, not realizing that, in fact, that scene is just an acting scene between two people who are essentially being presented in a two-shot, and is a very simple, almost a classic acting exercise of two people in a different place with different desires. And it makes it funny, and it makes it truthful, and it makes it real. And that was something I think that the readers didn't understand. And the film was not made for 17 years. Many years later, 12 years later, Edgar Sherrick sent the script to me. And exactly why he did, I don't know, but probably because he perceived it as even more of a comedy and maybe a teen coming of age picture than it was. Although perhaps he had great vision about my abilities. It certainly wasn't how the general industry perceived my work. And I fell in love with it and imagined Laura in the part from the day I read it. I called Laura and I sent the script to her, and she loved it. And I went to Edgar and I said I really wanted to do it, and I wanted Laura Dern to star in it. And they were at that time uncertain as to whether or not Laura had the kind of sexuality that she needed to be in the part. So Laura came in and met with Edgar, essentially dressed in the character of Rose, and talked about her family, and, you know, they've all known each other for a long time. But the minute Edgar laid eyes on this rather seductively dressed young lady, he said, well, we have our Rose, let's make this movie. And we didn't. We couldn't get it set up. About 6 months later, three quarters of a year later, I was doing a film with Diane, and I looked at her and realized that she was the perfect mother. She was Southern, she had 2 feet on the ground, she had a kind of a bookish intellectual side to her, but she certainly understood the fourth dimension. And I thought that perhaps she could play the mother, but asked myself, wait a minute, is there something wrong with thinking of Laura Dern, her daughter, and Diane Ladd playing characters who are not mother and daughter in a movie? But I looked at Diane's big brown eyes, and I thought, you know, they don't look alike. If I just went brunette with Diane, it could really work. So I gave her the script, and she loved it, so she wanted to do it. And then several years later, after years of calling up Calder Willingham's agent and telling him that I was going to make this movie somehow, and several other tries by Edgar and by Calder to get the picture made separately, Laura and I got together with Barry Mendel, Calder's agent, and started making lists of who to send this property to, who could exec produce it, who would have the clout to get it made. And at the same time, Laura said, look, could I just show this script to Rennie Harlan, who was a director who she started to see? And he'd asked her if he could read it. And so we said, sure, fine. Who would think that a man who directed Die Hard 2 and was an action director would fall in love with this material? But on the other hand, why not? He's a man. This is a man's story. He's fallen in love. This boy's fallen in love. It is a man's story, and it's one which touched him very deeply, and he felt the way we felt about the picture. And then he took it to another man who, again, wasn't frightened by the sexuality in the movie, but responded to it and saw that this could be a film that other people could respond to too, and that was Mario Casar. Again, no one in their right mind in the Hollywood system would ever take a film like Rambling Rose to Mario Casar, who had made Rambo and films like Total Recall, but Rennie did with great confidence, and I think it proves the point of the movie. The movie tells us not to be prejudicial about people's relationships and people's reputations. And getting the picture made was a proof of that as well, that the group who made that film, we were the perfect people to make it, and we made it the right way, and it came out of the Hollywood system. It's just not the usual track. It's not the usual thing that happens, and it took a very long time. The first thing that came to me in thinking about what the film should look like and how I'd like to create the vision of Rambling Rose was that this is a memory, that this is this boy's memory when he's a man, and that the kinds of things that we remember in our childhood, like our first love, come to us visually, like the memory I have of a beam of light coming through a kitchen door, a screen door, striking a kitchen table and the fruit bowl that sits on it. So it just sort of picks up and highlights certain aspects of the scene. And I remember the scene as tranquil and beautiful and vivid and alive and warm and rich. The colors are there and everything. And so I wanted in this film to have the golden light, have that sense of super reality, that certain things were highlighted. The sense of the richness of color, as well as the golden tone and warmth of sunlight. And therefore, rather than make a brown period movie, we had the challenge of combining color with those yellow tones that we wanted in the sunlight. And Johnny Jensen, when he read it, felt very much the same way. He, again, had the image of sunlight and a sense that Rose brings that light with her, that she comes in and warms up the family, enlightens the family, brings light to the family. And that really was where the visual construction of the movie began. And then we looked for sunlight in the exteriors as much as possible to, again, to highlight. This is the kind of control that you need to exercise. And the day that Laura walked through town was supposed to be a sunny day. We felt that the highlighting of the raised surfaces of the town and the dress and the clothing and the whole city would look a lot better in sunlight. And of course, it looked like it was about ready to rain. We were kind of dodging rain clouds the whole day, and occasionally the sun came out just for a second on a couple of her walks, but it was one of the big disappointments of the picture that we didn't get sun on that day. I think that the thing that typifies my work, and I'm probably not the best person to talk about this, is the way I work with actors, no matter all of the other elements of the movie, which of course I care about a great deal, it's really the actors that are up there right in front of everybody telling the story and delivering the words of the script. And when you put them together, in a sense, you've really put most of the picture together already. When I read Rambling Rose, I think the first thing that struck me was the incredible poetry of the dialogue. But what emerged out of the words in the movie were the themes of humanity, of love, of forgiveness, of sexuality, of a woman as the subject of a movie rather than the usual use of a woman as object in the movie. It was a movie that explored many personal themes in my life, themes of loss, of remembering family that's gone, of first love, of moral questions faced and conquered. And I felt that I had to make this movie. It was a movie which spoke to me in so many ways that despite the fact that I knew it would be a difficult film to set up, I felt I just had to make it. Rambling Rose gave me so much, having made it, that I really can hardly describe all the things that it might have done for me. But certainly, the picture taught me a great deal about the design of a movie and the complexity of construction. Calder is a very sophisticated writer, and I felt I innately understood his story and his themes. But the more I delved into the script and the more I delved into each scene, the more I realized how beautifully constructed this piece was, and how much interplay there was between the language and the kinds of words he used and the meaning of those lines and the complexity of the meaning. And then when you bring in actors like I had, the ramifications become enormous. And it was an incredible experience of watching something grow like that rose at the beginning and bloom, and to realize that it was all there, and you just had to cultivate it and bring it out and understand it and present it and then cut it so it all made sense. And it's a very powerful experience to have done that, because I know that movies can do that. The problem is we're not ambitious for all movies to do that, and so many movies really are not complex and they don't have so much to them. They may be fun and have other things, but it was a very enriching experience, and certainly changed my life. It changed my life both artistically and, of course, professionally as well.